सुशेखरार्चकं सुधीन्द्रसेव्य पादुकं सुतादिमोहनाशकं सुशान्तिदान्तिदायकं समस्तवेदपारगं सहस्रसूर्यभासुरं समाहिताखिलेन्द्रियं सदा भजामि शंकरं यदीय पुण्य जन्मनां प्रसिद्धिमाप कालटी यदीय शिष्य तां व्रजंसतोटकोपि पप्रथे येव सर्व देहिनां विमुक्ति मार्गदर्शको नराकृतिं सदाशिवं तमाश्रयामि सद्गुरुं नराकृतिं सदाशिवं तमाश्रयामि सद्गुरुं यदि यहस्तवारि जात सुप्रतिष्ठिता सती प्रसिद्ध शृंगभूधरे सदा प्रशांति भासुरे स्वभक्त पालन व्रता विराजते ही शारदास शंकर कृपानिधिः करोतु माम् अनेन सं ಸದಾಶಿವಸಮಾರಂಭಾಂ ಶಂಕರಾಚಾರ್ಯಮಧ್ಯಮಾಂ ಅಸ್ಮದಾಚಾರ್ಯಪರ್ಯಂತಾಂ ವಂದೇ ಗುರುಪರಂಪರಾಂ. ಶ್ರೀಶಂಕರಾಚಾರ್ಯವರ್ಯಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಬ್ರಹ್ಮಾನಂದಪ್ರದಾಯಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಅಜ್ಞಾನತಿಮಿರಾದಿತ್ಯಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸುಜ್ಞಾನಾಂಬುಧಿಚಂದ್ರಮಸೇ ನಮಃ. ವರ್ಣಾಶ್ರಮಪ್ರತಿಷ್ಠಾತ್ರೇ ನಮಃ. ಶ್ರೀಮತೇ ನಮಃ. ಮುಕ್ತಿಪ್ರದಾಯಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಶಿಷ್ಯೋಪದೇಶನಿರತಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಭಕ್ತಾಭೀಷ್ಟಪ್ರದಾಯಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸೂಕ್ಷ್ಮತತ್ವರಹಸ್ಯಜ್ಞಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಕಾರ್ಯಾಕಾರ್ಯಪ್ರಬೋಧಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಜ್ಞಾನಮುದ್ರಾಂಚಿತಕರಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಶಿಷ್ಯಹೃತ್ತಾಪಹಾರಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಪರಿವ್ರಾಜಾಶ್ರಮೋಧರ್ತ್ರೇ ನಮಃ. ಸರ್ವತಂತ್ರಸ್ವತಂತ್ರಧಿಯೇ ನಮಃ. ಅದ್ವೈತಸ್ಥಾಪನಾಚಾರ್ಯಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸಾಕ್ಷಾಚ್ಛಂಕರರೂಪಧೃತೇ ನಮಃ. ಷಣ್ಮತಸ್ಥಾಪನಾಚಾರ್ಯಾಯ ನಮಃ. ತ್ರಯೀಮಾರ್ಗಪ್ರಕಾಶಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ವೇದವೇದಾಂತತತ್ವಜ್ಞಾಯ ನಮಃ. ದುರ್ವಾದಿಮತಖಂಡನಾಯ ನಮಃ. ವೈರಾಗ್ಯನಿರತಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಶಾಂತಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸಂಸಾರಾರ್ನವತಾರಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಪ್ರಸನ್ನವದನಾಂಭೋಜಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಪರಮಾರ್ಥಪ್ರಕಾಶಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಪುರಾಣಸ್ಮೃತಿಸಾರಜ್ಞಾಯ ನಮಃ. ನಿತ್ಯತೃಪ್ತಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಮಹತೇ ನಮಃ. ಶುಚಯೇ ನಮಃ. ನಿತ್ಯಾನಂದಾಯ ನಮಃ. ನಿರಾತಂಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ನಿಸ್ಸಂಗಾಯ ನಮಃ. ನಿರ್ಮಲಾತ್ಮಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ನಿರ್ಮಮಾಯ ನಮಃ. ನಿರಹಂಕಾರಾಯ ನಮಃ. ವಿಶ್ವವಂದ್ಯಪದಾಂಬುಜಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸತ್ವಪ್ರಧಾನಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸದ್ಭಾವಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸಂಖ್ಯಾತೀತಗುಣೋಜ್ವಲಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಅನಘಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸಾರಹೃದಯಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸುಧಿಯೇ ನಮಃ. ಸಾರಸ್ವತಪ್ರದಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸತ್ಯಾತ್ಮನೇ ನಮಃ. ಪುಣ್ಯಶೀಲಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸಾಂಖ್ಯಯೋಗವಿಚಕ್ಷಣಾಯ ನಮಃ. ತಪೋರಾಶಯೇ ನಮಃ. ಮಹಾತೇಜಸೇ ನಮಃ. ಗುಣತ್ರಯವಿಭಾಗವಿದೇ ನಮಃ. ಕಲಿಘ್ನಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಕಾಲಕರ್ಮಜ್ಞಾಯ ನಮಃ. ತಮೋಗುಣನಿವಾರಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಭಗವತೇ ನಮಃ. ಭಾರತೀಜೇತ್ರೇ ನಮಃ. ಶಾರದಾಹ್ವಾನಪಂಡಿತಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಧರ್ಮಾಧರ್ಮವಿಭಾಗಜ್ಞಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಲಕ್ಷ್ಯಭೇದಪ್ರದರ್ಶಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ನಾದಬಿಂದುಕಳಾಭಿಜ್ಞಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಯೋಗಿ ಹೃತ್ಪದ್ಮಭಾಸ್ಕರಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಅತೀಂದ್ರಿಯಜ್ಞಾನನಿಧಯೇ ನಮಃ. ನಿತ್ಯಾನಿತ್ಯವಿವೇಕವತೇ ನಮಃ. ಚಿದಾನಂದಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಚಿನ್ಮಯಾತ್ಮನೇ ನಮಃ. ಪರಕಾಯ ಪ್ರವೇಶಕೃತೇ ನಮಃ. ಅಮಾನುಷಚರಿತ್ರಾಢ್ಯಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಕ್ಷೇಮದಾಯಿನೇ ನಮಃ. ಕ್ಷಮಾಕರಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಭವ್ಯಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಭದ್ರಪ್ರದಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಭೂರಿಮಹಿಂನೇ ನಮಃ. ವಿಶ್ವರಂಜಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸ್ವಪ್ರಕಾಶಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸದಾಧಾರಾಯ ನಮಃ. ವಿಶ್ವಬಂಧವೇ ನಮಃ. ಶುಭೋದಯಾಯ ನಮಃ. ವಿಶಾಲಕೀರ್ತಯೇ ನಮಃ. ವಾಗೀಶಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಸರ್ವಲೋಕಹಿತೋತ್ಸುಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಕೈಲಾಸಯಾತ್ರಾ ಸಂಪ್ರಾಪ್ತಚಂದ್ರಮೌಳೀಪ್ರಪೂಜಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಕಾಂಚ್ಯಾಂ ಶ್ರೀಚಕ್ರರಾಜಾಖ್ಯಯಂತ್ರಸ್ಥಾಪನದೀಕ್ಷಿತಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಶ್ರೀಚಕ್ರಾತ್ಮಕತಾಟಂಕತೋಷಿತಾಂಬಮನೋರಥಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಶ್ರೀಬ್ರಹ್ಮಸೂತ್ರೋಪನಿಷದ್ಭಾಷ್ಯಾದಿಗ್ರಂಥಕಲ್ಪಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಚತುರ್ದಿಕ್ಚತುರಾಂನಾಯ ಪ್ರತಿಷ್ಠಾತ್ರೇ ನಮಃ. ಮಹಾಮತಯೇ ನಮಃ. ದ್ವಿಸಪ್ತತಿಮತೋಚ್ಛೇತ್ರೇ ನಮಃ. ಸರ್ವದಿಗ್ವಿಜಯಪ್ರಭವೇ ನಮಃ. ಕಾಷಾಯ ವಸನೋಪೇತಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಭಸ್ಮೋಧೂಲಿತವಿಗ್ರಹಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಜ್ಞಾನಾತ್ಮಕೈಕದಂಡಾಢ್ಯಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಕಮಂಡಲುಲಸತ್ಕರಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಗುರುಭೂಮಂಡಲಾಚಾರ್ಯಾಯ ನಮಃ. ಭಗವತ್ಪಾದಸಮ್ಯಕಾಯ ನಮಃ. ವ್ಯಾಸಸಂದರ್ಶನಪ್ರೀತಾಯ ನಮಃ. ऋष्यशृङ्गपुरेश्वराय नमः सौन्दर्यलहरी मुख्यबहुस्तोत्रविधायकाय नमः चतुष्षष्टिकलाभिज्ञाय नमः ब्रह्मराक्षसमोक्षदाय नमः श्रीमन्मण्डनमिश्राख्यस्वयम्भूजय सन्नुताय नमः तोटकाचार्यसम्पूज्याय नमः पद्मपादार्चिताङ्घ्रिकाय नमः हस्तामलकयोगीन्द्रब्रह्मज्ञानप्रदायकाय नमः सुरेश्वराख्यसच्छिष्यसन्न्यासाश्रमदायकाय नमः नृसिंहभक्ताय नमः सद्रत्नगर्भहेरम्बपूजकाय नमः व्याख्यासिंहासनाधीशाय नमः जगत्पूज्याय नमः जगद्गुरवे नमः श्रीमच्छङ्करभगवत्पादाचार्यस्वामिने नमः.
श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः. Welcome to all of you to a great experience of the glory of Acharyas and our Sringeri Peetham. We are very happy in Tattva Loka. We have the opportunity to host this Guru Parampara series since last year. Last year we had the first lecture by Narur Swamihal, who came and spoke about Chandrasekhar Bharati Swamihal. Beautiful lecture. So I'm very happy that's followed by a set of lectures by a great devotee, an eminent personality, and one who excels in everything along with deep humility, Mr. N. Venkatraman. Please give a rising healthcare to him. Most of you certainly will be knowing him. Mr. Venkatraman has been a senior advocate and a corporate lawyer in Supreme Court. In fact, he became a senior advocate at the age of 40, one of the rare privileges which good people in this profession get. He was a junior to C. Natarajan for about 14 years. And his immense qualifications, his professional excellence, and his great expertise in corporate law, indirect taxation, all those things are one part of it. But most significant part of it is how he excels in dharmic path, how he shows a life of rituous life with a great sense of contentment and a great sense of guru bhakti. That is something which he is a beacon light. His mother's village is Melmangalam, which Acharya himself has called Chinna Sringeri. It is a beautiful village near Madurai. And his father's village is Kodimangalam near Solavandan, where the family deity Balathipurasundari temple is managed by him. But more importantly, he runs a Veda Padashala, which I am personally aware of it, in his mother's place, Melmangalam, which today hosts 50 Vidyarthis with the state-of-the-art facilities, and started about 10 years ago with just 2 students. The Padashala now maintains its minimum strength between 50 to 60 Vidyarthis. And it is blessed to be associated with number of facilities, including teachers' accommodation there. And I personally know how he sends his Vidyarthis to important congregations, including the one annual in Karur, as I am personally aware of the temple Sringeri Madam in Karur, where Vidyarthis come, is transported by special bus, and they do excellent rendering of Ekadan Laksharchana, and also with chantings. The dharmic activities of Mr. Venkatraman is not known to many. I think true to Bhagavad Gita's teachings, he keeps everything secret, because whatever you do, especially good things, you never make it known to public. But his adoration of the Guru and his immense faith and devotion to the Guru Parampara is something legendary. I personally know that how he has been blessed by Mahaswamigal, Mahasannidhanam, and how today the 1.5 kilo gold vigraha of Uma Maheshwara, which he donated to the Swamiji, he is now adoring the Swamiji's daily puja in Sringeri. Not only that, he has given huge sort of ornaments, including Abhayahasta of the vigraha of Sardambal, which today goes along with Sri Sannidhanam in his Karan Vijay Yatra. So he has number of things he has done that he has never makes it known. He is such a humble person and highly intellectual and at the same time highly, highly humble and knowledgeable. So very, very happy that we had the opportunity to host his series of lectures on Guru Parampara in Tattvaloka Auditorium. Those of you who are coming to this auditorium will know that this edifice created in 2005 has been hailed as one place where the divine vibrations are felt by everybody who plays here. Whether it's a giving discourse or an artist or it's a singing, they feel that immense presence of Guru presents bhakti, and that's because the Gurus are both sides. And when Mahasannidhanam came here and did the puja here in this very same hall, we all felt the great vibrations here. So I'm happy that this venue is fortunate to hold the Vande Guru Paramparam program of Sri Venkatraman. There's going to be 2 lectures today. Jagadguru Shankara Bhagavatpada is today, followed by Jagadguru Vidyashankara Mahaswamihal and Jagadguru Vidyaranya Swamihal, including Vijayanagara Empire and Sringeri Jagadguru Bridavalli will be tomorrow. Next month, on 27th and 28th, we have 2 lectures. One on Jagadguru Narasimha Bharati Mahaswamihal and Sri Satchananda Shubhabhinava Narasimha Bharati Mahaswamihal, and followed by Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamihal. That will be on next month. And in August, we'll have 2 Jeshta Mahasannidham Jagadguru Abhinav Vidyartha Mahaswamigal, 2 lectures. And in September, we'll have 2 lectures on current Mahasannidhanam and also Sri Sannidhanam. And this series of lectures for this year will be completed. I'm sure we'll have opportunity to involve him and have the benefit of his erudition, his knowledge, and his great Guru Bhakti rendering in this forum for the benefit of all of us. Once again, thank you very much for all of you taking time to come here. And those of you who are not left your email ID, please leave it at the beginning, at the counter. We will enroll you and send you all the programs. Everything is free. As you know, this venue is created for the benefit of Sanatana Dharma, propagation of values, spiritual values, a whole number of programs, whether it's discourses, dances, with Katha Kalakshepam, and also with the very Chitra Madhavan gives on scientific slide-based, PowerPoint-based presentations on some of the historical temple architecture. So all the programs you are welcome to attend. So those of you who have not had the benefit of attending this one, please leave your card. And also, if you express interest, we'll give you a free copy of Tattvaloka, which sure you will cherish. And you will be happy to read it. Not only that, we'll also pass on to your friends and relatives. And whoever reads Tattvaloka, they get immensely immersed with it. In fact, we just brought 2 issues on spirituality in Andhra Pradesh, just last 2 issues. And people sent series of letters complimenting us, how it becomes a collector's item. And now the next 2 issues are going to be on Madhya Pradesh, including the hoary traditions of Ujjain, Mahakaleshwar, and all other Narmada. Series of articles are going to come on Madhya Pradesh. So most welcome for to be Tattvaloka family and be benefited by it. Thank you once again for your presence. Thank you. I now request Sri Venkatraman to come, please. Thank you.
Mala Sudakumba Vibodha Mudra Vidhyavirajat Karavari Jatam Aparakarunya Sudam Burachim Shri Sharadam Bam Pranatosmi Nityam Shankarupena Marchittam Panki Kadamabhutyaya Kinkariyasa Samaya Shankaracharyamashaye Prahladavarado Devo Yonusam Mahparo Harihi Nusumopasakam Nityam Tam Nusumma Gurumbaje Shri Sachidananda Shivabhinavya Nusumma Bharatyabhitan Yati Indran Vidya Nitin Mantra Nitin Sadatma Nishtan Bhaje Manava Shambhurupan Sadatma Dhyana Niratam Vishayebhya Paran Mukam Naumi Shastreshu Nishnatam Chandrasekara Bharati Vivekinam Mahaprakyam Dairyo Daryakshamanidim Sada Abhinava Purvam Tam Vidya Thirtha Gurum Bhaje Agyanam Janna Vititam Vidya Thirtham Vivekinam Sarvesham Shukatam Tirtham Bharati Thirthamashraye Vidya Vinaya Sampannam Vitarakam Vivekinam Vande Vedanta Tatvyakyam Vidushekhara Bharati Shantam Padmasanastam Sashitara Makutam Panchavaktram Trinetram Shulam Vajram Shakatkam Parasumabhayadam Dakshabhage Vahantam Nagam Pasham Shakantam Pralayahutavakam Sankusham Vamabhage Nana Halankara Yuktam Spatikamanilibam Parvadesham Namami Aruna Kirana Jalehi Angshita Shavakasha Vidurtha Japavatika Pustaka Bhitihasta Itharavarkaratya Pulla Kallara Susta Nivasutu Hritibala Ritya Kalyana Shila Vasudeva Sutantevam Kamsachanu Ramadhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Bande Jagadgurum. I offer myself at the lotus feet of Jeshta Mahasannidhanam, Mahasannidhanam and Sannidhanam. May their grace prevail upon me and may they throw light and guide to speak what is good, what is correct and what is accurate before all of you. When it comes to divine lectures, we can possibly classify speakers into three broad categories. The first and the foremost would be those Anugraha Bhashanams given by our Acharyas. We call them as Anugraha Bhashanam for the simple reason it's not just a lecture or a talk or communication of words. They pass, they convey their blessings through that speech, which is capable of transforming an individual. That's one category of the prime category of doing a bhashanam. There is a second category of speakers who have given their entire life, spent their entire time in the propagation of Vedic Dharma and Sanatana Dharma, whom we call them as Pravachanakartas. They read so well, they are so knowledgeable, spend considerable time in developing penetrative in-depth knowledge, ready to withstand any debate and deliver what is right and what Sanatana Dharma actually signifies to each one of us. I offer my humble prostrations and namaskarams to the entire fraternity of Pravachanakartas. And there is a third category of speakers who are innocent, completely ignorant, just bestowed by sheer grace with some devotion. These speakers just can't be anywhere between the first two categories. They stand up for anything and everything based on endowed grace. And they only attempt in platforms like this to share their experiences, the experiences of co-devotees, more from an emotional, more from a realistic and life-realizing angles, rather than in-depth insight or deep penetrative knowledge in Vedanta or the Vedas. The speaker before you falls under the third category. And when you judge or hear, you should bear this aspect in mind throughout the lecture. I prostrate once again before the acharyas of our Peetam, and I step in to speak a few words in this direction. I should at the outset thank our administrator and CEO, Dr. V.R. Gauri Shankar. When I wrote a mail about this lecture series, in less than 5 minutes, I got a response from him supporting the whole cause. And he did utter a word of caution that you should be well prepared, read all the text to the best of your ability, and you should ensure that it is useful to the listeners and to the mutt. So I'm very thankful for his spontaneous response and support to this lecture series. I've relied on the text of Tapasyananda when it comes to Shankara Digvijayam, and also the writings of our noble soul, late Narayana Sami Mama, Shingeriyil Shankarar, and the publications of Vidyatitha Foundation and that of the Ramco Publications. These are the source text. There is no creative imagination or any effort in this direction. It's all based only on text well known and known for its authenticity and accuracy. With these few words, let me venture to address what little God has blessed me to speak to you all. How was India before the birth of Saint Adi Shankara? A picturization will make us understand the purpose of this rare, important birth. Sanatana Dharma, all of us know, has two parts. The Vedic part, or the Karmakanda, and the Vedanta, which is the Vichara, or the Nyana. It's a seamless connect. You start from Karmakanda, keep progressing slowly, and ultimately realize what you are through the help, guidance, and grace of one's guru. One cannot exist without the other. They are the two sides of the very, very same coin called the Sanatana Dharma. Jeshtha Mahasannidhanam, Jagadguru Srimad Abhinava Vidyatirthar, in one of his discourses, says, with the passage of time, somehow Jnana Marga started to disappear, or did not gain or stay in that prominence. World started to only preach, practice, and highlight the importance of karmas. Rituals was the basis. Life starts and ends with rituals. That was the message at that point of time. This gave the opportunity for intellectuals to start their own religions. What was their agenda? Someone took just the meditative and contemplative part of Sanatana Dharma and made it into a religion. Somebody took ahimsa from our dharma and made it into a religion. Somebody took the charity part, the service, which was part of our Vedic dharma, discerned it and created a religion. And their agenda was shun Vedas, because they don't want prescriptions or injunctions sanctioned by Vedas. Shun God and just develop these traits in you. So what happened over a period of time? However noble their thoughts could have been, when each one undergoes a passage of time, when they started progressing without God and without Vedas, it came to a situation that rewards and punishments came to be delivered without sanctions. So it was a scenario that, if I can relate it to our modern understanding, if each one of you tries to write your own Indian penal code to administer criminal justice in this country, what will happen to that? You decide the crime, you decide the punishment, and you decide how it has to be also adjudicated. Everything is your call. So over a period of time, world slowly drifted into a path where every individual started to proclaim their claims as a religion by itself. Utter chaos. This was the situation. Therefore, there is a beautiful conversation which is recorded in Shankara Digvijayam. Lord Shiva speaks to Skanda and tells him there are three strands on which the edifice of Sanatana Dharma rests: the Karmakanda, and the other extreme is the Nyana Kanda, and the transition process is meditation and contemplation. When you have three strands, Shiva says, I have already requested Hari and Adishesha to be born as Shankarshana and Patanjali to take care of the middle path, the meditative yoga part. And directs Skanda to be born as Kumarilabhatta to propagate the Karma Marga, and said, Lord Shiva will descend into this world as Adi Shankara Bhagavatpada to re-establish jnana alone fetches realization. It is in this backdrop that a necessity came for an avataram to revitalize and re-establish the supremacy of Advaita Tattva. So how was Shankara born? Both Shivaguru and Aryamba had a dream. Shivaguru had a dream, which she shared it. And Lord Shiva appeared in the dream and gave an option. Do you want an all-illuminating sun, but short-lived? Or a long life-awaited sun, who may not be prominent as in the case of the first category? Without even waiting for a second, the parents opted for the first category. And that's how Adi Shankara was born to them. Nature gave only 8 years of lifespan to Saint Adi Shankara. Just 8 years. And Shankara is known, all of us know what Shankara would mean. He's nothing but a bestower of happiness. If we understand, all of us in the modern mind looks at a date chart. What did one do between their birth and their departure? If you see the date chart of Adi Shankara, it's simply baffling to your modern mind. At the age of one, he has gained proficiency in all the languages. At the age of one. In his second year, he has mastered Kavyas and Puranas. Fifth year, Upanayanam is performed without his father, who died when Shankara was just 3 years old. Between the fifth year and the seventh year, he has mastered all the four Vedas, Vedantas, Veda Ankas, and every auxiliary study relating to Veda and Vedic knowledge. So he completed acquiring knowledge within 7 years. Eighth year, his guru gives him the sannyasa when he was just an 8-year-old tender child. In the 12th year, he completes writing the commentaries on the Prasthanatraya, Bhagavad Gita, 10 principal Upanishads, and the Brahma Sutra at the age of 12. At the age of 16, he has the at 8 years, when he was about to take sannyasam, Agastya extended his life from 8 years to 16 years. He said, nature gifted you 8 years, let me gift you 8 more years for you. And therefore, he completed all his works at the age of 12 and got it duly validated by Bhagavan Vyasa at the age of 16. And said before the lotus feet of Bhagavan Vyasa, my time to depart has come. May I do that in your presence? Vyasa says, then it'll be an half-served purpose. You have completed your writings, but world should know your writings. You should establish the supremacy because 72 different schools of thought were prevalent at the time of advent of Adi Shankara. And therefore, Bhagavan Vyasa said, let me extend your life by another 16 years. So 8 became 16 and 16 became 32. And in the balance 16 years, he has traveled into India thrice. Stayed in Sringeri longest, 12 long years out of the 32. In one place, Holy Sringeri. Debated, convinced, persuaded, brought every school of thought. It all got subsumed into the supremacy of Advaita. And at 32, after ascending the Sarvajna Peetam at Kashmir, goes to Badri, goes to Kedar, and disappears and merges into his holy abode at Shivaloka. Does it not baffle our minds? And Digvijayam says, in Vedas, he looked like Brahma. In Vedanta, he looked like Vyasa. In Karmas, he looked like Jaimini. The power of speech, he looked like Saraswati. In courage, he looked like Durga. In glory, he looked like Mahalakshmi. And in patience, he just looked like Bhumadevi. We only see multi-complex temples in modern world. All deities housed in one human form is Adi Shankara. Now, for anybody who believes in Guru Tattvam, what is paramount is how did he reach his guru and how did his guru take him? I think there can't be a more supreme moment to anybody in one's life than meeting with the guru and the love and nurture the guru gives on his sishya. He takes to sannyasam under tried circumstances. It was a trap. He was the only child to his mother, who would not condescend to this request at any point of time. And after all, she knew that he is not going to stay beyond 8 years, and with the mercy of Agastya, it has been extended to 16 years. She would like to have the son only with her. So the crocodile story is built into Digvijayam to say, when he was bathing, it's the crocodile which was about to eat him. It caught his feet. And he therefore virtually bargained with his mother. You want me to see alive or dead? If you want to see me alive, allow me to take to sannyasa. Then the crocodile will not do anything. That's how the promise is given. He extracts a promise. She grants sannyasa and extracts a promise that I'm willingly giving you, you can take to sannyasa. And scriptures say that if for a bachelor to go to sannyasa ashramam, if mother is alive, the blessings and the consent of mother is mandatory. And therefore, she said, you are my only child. If you take to sannyasa, who will be by my side at the time of death? So Shankara gave two promises. I will be by your side and I will take care of you. And therefore, question, when I come to that section, I will deal with it. Questions have been raised. How can a sannyasi be by his mother's side and perform the rites? Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam has answered it so beautifully in one of his lectures. So he becomes a sannyasi at age of 8, adorns a kashaya vastram, takes the dandam and the kamandalam, and from Kaladi proceeds to Narmada, which is in Madhya Pradesh, reaches river Narmada and the beautiful cave in which his guru was meditating, Saint Govinda Bhagavatpada. The cave is even today there for worship. How was the meeting? What did the guru offer first to his sishya? A sishya who's so unique in every aspect of life. It's a cave, almost closed, says the commentary. And his guru first took his holy feet out of the cave and blessed the holy head of Adi Shankara. It's not a meeting, it was not a greeting, it was not a prostration, it was not a namaskaram. The holy feet of a guru touching the sishya's head. What else do you need at that moment? See, Shankara is the avataram of Shiva, that's our faith. So there is no need to get an evolutionary workout in this manner. After all, he's an evolved soul. He's a sarvajnan by himself. But the message that is driven to is, if a sarvajnan at that age is a sishya, the sishya has to be initiated into the path of emancipation by a guru. There is no exception to this law. Just no exception. If the most divine form, assuming a human form, has to go through the process of realization, and the realization comes only through the initiation by one's own guru. And therefore, to evidence that and record it as part of history, Shankara was initiated into eternal bliss by his guru, Govinda Bhagavatpada. And Digvijayam describes beautifully how was the 8-year-old boy looking at that time. Was he so competent to be emancipated instantaneously? Digvijayam records, when he stood before his guru, he was an embodiment manifesting very clearly as one who has acquired the four basic virtues, what we call it as sadhana chatushti: vivekam, vairagyam, the six virtues, shat sampat, shamadama, and finally mumukshutvam. Vairagyam, vivekam, is in our understanding is discriminatory knowledge, the ability to discriminate between truth and the untruth. Vairagyam is the ability to remain non-attached. Vairagyam is not abandonment. Vairagyam is non-attachment. You can be in the thick of things. Because Shankara was a yogi, a karma yogi. He was so active all throughout his life, but completely detached. Then you have the samadama, in short, sense control, mind control, tolerant to external and internal forces. And two important criteria in the six virtues are Shraddha and Samadhi. And Shingeri Acharyals, whenever they divine discourse of Anugraha Bhashanam, when they take to the expression Shraddha, you can listen any lecture of any Acharya. They have always been giving one consistent interpretation. Shraddha has two components: unflinching, unquestionable loyalty to the Vedic scriptures. And secondly, undoubted faith and surrender to the words of the Guru. Whatever the Guru says is final. So, one who is bestowed with these two virtues is called a person with Shraddha in scriptural standards. When it comes to Samadhi, delusions, lethargy, sleeplessness, distractions, a mind sands all these negativities. And mumukshutvam is the longing to get emancipated. Imagine a child, 8-year-old child, standing before his guru with all these virtues. Will then not the guru step out to ensure that such a soul is emancipated? And how was the emancipation? What is the emancipation process? Instantaneously, he was initiated into all the four Mahavakyas from all the four Vedas. All the four Mahavakyas. When it comes to Rigvedam, Prajnanam Brahma, Yajurvedam, Aham Brahmasmi, Samavedam, Tattvamasi, and Atharvana Vedam, I am Atma Brahma. To get near any one of the Mahavakyam takes millions of births. And somebody gets all the four at once. And that is Adi Shankara. On getting this initiation, Govinda Bhagavatpada narrates a wonderful incident. He said to Shankara, when Bhagavan Vyasa had the occasion to have a meeting with Bhagavan Vyasa, I had requested him to write a commentary for his Vedanta Sutras. Because he has written the sutras, but its interpretation looked manifold and completely deviating from what was intended. So Govinda Bhagavatpada asked Bhagavan to write the commentary. And Bhagavan Vyasa said, I don't have to do it. Wait for your Sishya to come. Then Govinda Bhagavatpada asks, how do I know that that is the Sishya who is competent to write? How will I know that? Then Vyasa says, don't worry. One day, to your surprise, you will find a Sishya who is able to control and just hold the entire spate of flood of Reva River into his Kamandalu. You will see that divine feat in your life. The person who does that will be the competent Shishya to author the commentaries on Brahma Sutras, on all the Sutras, Brahma Sutra and the Prasthanatraya. And says, when Shankara actually brought the flood, which was in spate, into his Kamandala, said, you are the Shishya to do this. And said, please proceed to Kashi. You will have the divine blessings of Lord Shiva and Mata Annapurni. She will shower her choicest blessings. Now, in his entire life of 32 years, there are three important divine meetings which happen in the life history of Adi Shankara. The meeting with Lord Shiva, the meeting with Bhagavan Vyasa, and his guru's guru, Gaudapada. These three meetings have enormous spiritual significance. But for a modern mind, I thought we should also discern lesser truths from those so that we are able to use it in our lifetime to the best of our abilities. First is the meeting with Lord Shiva. After reaching Kashi, Shankara on an afternoon goes to his normal bath at Ganges to offer his prayers and finds a hunter with four dogs coming opposite to him. Shankara says, can you just step aside? I need to walk through. Then the hunter stares at Bhagavatpada and asks, what are you asking me to do? You appear to be a person propounding the theory of Advaita, where self alone is truth, the body is illusion. If you advocate such a truth to the world, how can you ask me, this body, to step aside, which is illusion? And truth exists everywhere because it's omnipresent. If you say you are the self, it has no place to move because it exists everywhere. If you say, I have to move, then you're asking the body to move, which is illusion. So what do I do? Shankara says, you are verily my guru. And Lord Shiva immediately appears in that place and says, go to Badri and do the commentaries on Brahma Sutra. Now, from a philosophical plank, this is a very important episode for people who are in Vichara. The simple point is, as long as you have a dual sense, my body and your body, it's an indication that you have not actually evolved to reach the truth or you haven't reached that destination. That's the test. This is exactly what the philosophical truth which comes out of this episode. But there is a modern thinking to it. Modern minds, what can we learn? After all, again, Shankara is a Sarvajna. Why should he play this drama? What is that that he seeks to guide to each one of us out of this drama? Let's not think of higher philosophy today. Let's think of one aspect. The biggest challenge which all of us in modern world to confront is one's own ego. Ego is the biggest challenger. It's the biggest enemy. It's the biggest threat. Now, this story preaches the truth, an invaluable truth. Deception is part of life. Don't get deceived by looks. Don't judge people by just their forms. Don't underestimate based on their background. Don't be judgmental about human beings, because you can more often err than arrive at a correct solution. Number one. The second message it tries to draw, because appearance is deceptive, the person who is judged tells you a profound truth. It happens every day in our modern life. You get so easily deceived, seeing that, so who is he to teach us? And from him or from her comes out a very invaluable truth or a suggestion. Then the mind has two options. A mind soaked in ego will challenge it. It can't accept that it has been deceived. It will keep challenging it. Then you walk to the path of ruin. You are not going to progress, whether it's a project or a planning or a decision or a family discussion. You apply it to anything. So when you feel that you are deceived, somebody has been deceptive, and they still try to communicate something to you in your life, if you challenge with your ego that I'm not ready to accept this deception, it's not going to give you the solution. Alternatively, if you condescend and obey to that yes, indeed I have been deceived, and this is your real strength, and this is your real merit, you need to be acknowledged for that. The hunter turned out to be a Shiva and rewarded Shankara with one of the rarest privileges, the one and only Shankara to have written the commentaries of Brahma Sutra, which is the benchmark ultimate truth in our scriptures, which remains unconquered, unchallenged for 1,200 years, those commentaries. Any amount of debate, nobody has succeeded. See, all of us think in 2018 we can challenge God. People, YouTube, you switch on to the YouTube, you see filth in every form possible. Why? Because person who talks doesn't read. Person who listens is also not knowledgeable. And therefore, we feel that maybe they are right. The best of questions, the worst of questions have been answered by the epics, by Sanatana Dharma. There is nothing which is left out. One needs to know, that's all. Answers are there. We should develop the capability to reach out to the answer to convince the opponent to say that he's wrong or she's wrong. Shankara did it in all its sense. So this is the truth that the episode of Shiva delivers. Now come to the second episode. Shankara completes the Brahma Sutra at the age of 12. The commentary on Brahma Sutra at the age of 12. Then as he was from Badri, he comes back to Kashi. And he was with his disciples. A disguised Brahmin appeared before him and said, I understand that you have written some commentary on Brahma Sutra. Is it so? Look at this. Shankara has already completed his works. He could have simply said, yes, yes, I am the one who has completed it. And just ignored that human being. He said, yes, I have been blessed to author this. Then he said, is it so? Then I would like to question you and try to understand whether your commentaries can stand the test of time. Shankara responds, saying that you may do so, but let me make myself very clear. I will attempt to answer to the best of my ability. In fact, Acharya in the various Anugraha Bhashtams, when he refers to this episode, says, if you want to cite somebody as an epitome of humility, it is Adi Shankara. Somebody who has mastered everything before 7 years and authored everything before 12 years, when confronted, says, I will try to answer to the best of my ability. Then he doesn't leave. He picks up the question, and the debate goes on and on for 8 long days. Then Shankara's disciple Padmapada understands that this Brahmana is nobody else but Bhagavan Vyasa. And Shankara prostrates. Now, for a modern mind, what does it try to preach? We saw in the Shiva episode, if you accept deception. If you accept and acknowledge our mistakes, there is a reward waiting thereafter. Now, what is the reward? You are asked to do a unique piece of work. Now, somebody completes that unique piece of work. When we do even an ordinary feat, we make it into an extraordinary feat in our thought. We propagate, do the propaganda best to say it is an unreachable feat, and starts branding it, starts capsuling it, starts promoting it, do everything that is possible. Now here is a person, the ultimate in scripture, he has written commentaries and waits in the banks of the Ganges and ready to engage into a debate with somebody who wants to confront him and says, with utter humility, I'll try to answer to my best. So, accomplishing a feat through the grace of God is something which can happen in our lives regularly or rarely, or everyone gets an opportunity to do that. When you reach that crescendo, then God keeps testing you. How do you react to that success? Do you take that success to your head? Do you take that success to your heart? Do you take your success to be nothing but your ego? It's a manifestation of your ego and your effort. However way, in whichever way you perceive, then if whatever work which you might done may be classic, will not remain recognized there. Achievements followed with humility alone stays in this world. That's the message Bhagavan Vyasa tries to impart through this episode. And says this commentary will withstand the test of time. And as long as sun and moon keeps rising and in, sinking back into the clouds, into the akasha, this work will remain as a crowning jewel in the panorama of Indian scriptures. Sheer humility. Now come to the third episode, the meeting with Gaudapada. Gaudapada is the guru for Govinda Bhagavatpada, and Govinda Bhagavatpada was the guru of Adi Shankara. Adi Shankara meets Bhagavan Vyasa at the age of 16. And when this meeting got over, he says, now that you have given the validation that this is a work which will stand the test of time, nature gave me 8 years, Agastya extended to 16 years, time has come for me to depart. May I do that in your holy presence? Bhagavan Vyasa says, a job of writing is only at endeavor half finished. This writing has to reach. This should be contested, and you'll have to win over debates across and establish the supremacy of Advaita Tattva. And therefore, I shall extend your life from 16 years to 32 years. Now, the third important meeting with Gaudapada happens just before Adi Shankara completes his life journey. All is over. 72 schools of thought had been comprehensively defeated. And world is following nothing but Advaita. At that point of time, he meets Gaudapada. And the supermaster, seeing Adi Shankara, says, you are a person endowed with devotion, faith, renunciation, and one who has direct experience of Brahma. You are a person who has gained mastery on the six instinctive urges of mind. You are a person who has gained proficiency in the six-limbed yoga. You have acquired the sixfold spiritual excellence, and you have drawn your mind into the spirit and dissolved it. This is how I see you as Shankara at this stage. Again, a test for human ego. If somebody compliments one trillionth of this to us, we'll start floating in life as though the whole world is under our feet. When such an encomium is paid by the Parameshti Guru on Shankara, Bhagavatpada reacts as usual. All this happens because I am in your presence, says the divine presence can transform a dumb with the power to speak like Saraswati. This is the power of a guru. And I am before the guru. I am before my guru's guru. And I can't be different. It has nothing to do with my own abilities or efforts. It's divine grace. So, please connect these three episodes as a necklace for a normal, modern human mind. Every time there is a challenge to the ego, if we yield, it produces invaluable rewards and results. We fail to do that. None of us can do that every time. It's not possible. But it preaches this supreme truth. If you confront a situation which challenges one's ego, if we condescend that moment, there's every possibility for a divine support to follow. There is every possibility for you to see the story of Shankara. From 8 years to 32 years, whatever he has embarked upon, whatever he has journeyed upon into, and whatever he has produced remains incomparable classic. It remains unique. Because he lived a life of 32 years free of ego. So these three episodes together convey that important meaning to your modern mind. And the last darshanam was, to which I thought I should share, is the darshanam of Lord Narasimha. A kapalika whose job was only to chop off the heads, the holy heads of people, and offer it as lotus flowers to his god Bhairava, was in search of a head which is a king's head or a head of a holy priest, holy saint, and approached Shankara and said, "It is impossible for me to reach a king and take his head. It's not possible. Whereas you are accessible to me. I want your head so that I will live. My desires will get completely fulfilled." Shankara said, "Take my head. I have no problem." And said, uttered a caution, "Look here, my disciples are very devoted to me. So you must come to a place and come at a time when I'm alone. Otherwise, I'm also inaccessible. My devotees will not allow this to happen." So a time was chosen contractually and a place, everything was identified. And Digvijayam explains it beautifully. What did Shankara do? Took to the Padmasana position and reached the supreme Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Withdraw the senses into the mind. Mind into the spirit. And become motionless. Stay disconnected from the surroundings. You become indifferent totally to the surroundings. So he reached this position in just few seconds and said, "I'm ready. If you want, you take my head." At that time, Padmapada, one of his disciples, is a Narasimha Upasaka. Narasimha he became himself a Narasimha. Tore the chest of the Kapali, like how Narasimha actually did in the case of Hiranyakashipu. Killed him, and Narasimha emerged before Adi Shankara. What does this story convey to all of us? You may be in the worst of peril, a situation which is irretrievable to you. It's gone. It's over. In that situation, if you surrender your ego at the lotus feet of God and say, well, I don't have any options. Any workable options are now not available to us. Whatever can happen, it can happen only through a divine action. If we are able to yield to that state of mind, as Narasimha appeared to kill the Kapalika, God will appear in our life every moment. I will just narrate you a very, very pathetic incident which turned out to be the most divine, supreme experience for that family. I say this in a public forum with a sense of responsibility because I know this incident. It's not something which read from the textbooks or what Nischalamana Bhakti can yield something to someone. This family is a great devoted family to the Acharyas Paramparai. For generations, they have been serving the mutt. During the times of Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam, which is several decades before, when the society was not so affluent, and naturally, mutt had its own constraint, the person will simply go to Mahasannidhanam, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam, offer his worship and move away. And when he moves away out, they will find out a 10,000 rupee bundle, saying that 60 years back. So when somebody will say, who has left it, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam usually would reply every time, he is the devotee who does it. You don't have to go in search of him. Such a devoted family. His granddaughter and his son-in-law ventured into a business. Absolute crash. Crash in the sense, irretrievable crash. Huge debts, which they just can't liquidate in their lifetime. So, they were living in a flat in a residential locality in Chennai and just did not know what to do. So the debtor, who was once a friend, now turned a foe, sent three guys, virtual mercenaries, three fellows one day in the night landed into their house and said that henceforth we will park ourselves only in your house. We will drink, we will eat what we want. We are going to be part of this house till such time you find some means to pay my boss. Three fellows stormed into their house. Imagine a residential locality with some semblance of decency, managing their lives. Three fellows rock into it. The man walks out of his house. At that point, I'm saying this 20, 22 years back, walks out of the house and goes to the nearest telephone booth. Those days, we used to have red type. So calls his brother-in-law and says, this is the situation. What do I do? The brother-in-law says, well, I can't help. I don't know what to do myself. Whatever was available resources with me, I have liquidated and given to my sister. I have nothing else to share now. So, after 15 minutes of conversation, they decided, let's leave it to nature. Just a situation where nothing is possible. What can you do? To whom will you go and ask money? Who is going to fund you? So the man virtually wept over that phone. So the guy who was maintaining that telephone booth saw him and asked him, what is actually happening? Can you tell me? So he narrated the incident and said that this is how we started our life. And he was actually a vice president in a leading company, picked up the desire to do business, and this is where we are in a mess. And three fellows are. Then he asks, who funded you? He said, so-and-so funded. Thank you so much, you can go. Let's pray, sir, see what happens. After 2 hours, these three fellows stand up and say, I am so sorry. My boss has recalled all the three of us back. We are quitting this place. You could have told that you know so-and-so, so-and-so. Then we would not have come into your house at all. All the three fellows, within a span of 2 hours, quit the place. Man was puzzled. He kept on thinking, my brother-in-law could not have done it. He's staying 500 kilometers away in some place. He could not have done it to me. And I did not converse with anybody else recently. I'm hiding actually. Then he recollected, the only possible person to whom he has talked is the fellow who is managing the telephone booth. So he went back to him after 3 hours. And first did a call to his brother-in-law, crying for 20 minutes, narrating what happened to him now. Fellows who are planning to drink, eat, whatever they want, and just ruin peace into the house, quits. And he was narrating this. And comes out and asked him politely, sir, this is what has happened, but I don't know how it happened. Then the booth collector says, sir, I'm a son to the second wife of so-and-so, so-and-so. And the son of the first wife is one of the leading politicians in the state. When I saw you in tears explaining your position, my heart couldn't resist. I called up my half-brother and said, somebody from whom nothing can be recovered is being tortured, and I want your interference. He said, who is the fellow who is doing this? And I told him, so-and-so has done this. He said, don't worry, in an hour's time, these fellows will be out of the house. I think my half-brother should have talked to him and evicted these three guys. This is the possibility I visualize. See the connects in life. Absolutely new. Out of the box. If you are helpless and if you are ready to surrender your ego, God will be with you at every point of time, is what it narrates. Now we'll go to the next section. The four great disciples of Adi Shankara, who later became the four Pithadhipatis, the Chaturam Nayapitam, the four mutts created by Adi Shankara, established in the four corners of. In fact, our Mahasannidhanam, in a recent speech in Telugu, explains it beautifully when he explained the Namavali, Chaturthik Chaturam Naya Pratishthatre Namaka. He says, maybe Adi Shankara thought the whole of India conceived it as a Yajna Bhumi. And for a Yajna, you need four sites. And installed these four mutts in the four parts of the country. Very recent speech in Telugu says so. So who are those four prime disciples and what can we learn out of them? The first disciple is Padmapada. Padmapada is known for his devotion and his knowledge. These were the two rare qualities bestowed on Padmapada. So each disciple had a unique feature. Padmapada had that feature. Ability to be devoted and exceedingly knowledgeable. In fact, Shankara taught all his commentaries thrice to him in these 32 years. Three times he was taught the entire commentaries. Now, this disciple also underwent a test. and he came out with a super brilliant success. He was on the other side of Ganges. Now, the rest of the disciples were very jealous about him, naturally. So Shankara decided to show or prove something to them, how extraordinary he is, and therefore how beloved he is to him. So when he was on the other side of Ganges, Shankara called Padmapada. The call of the Guru, that's the message this episode seeks to teach. The call of the Guru is supreme. Padmapada thought, when my Guru can navigate me and take me beyond the oceans of samsara, is it going to be difficult for my Guru to help me in crossing this river? He therefore set his foot into the river. And the commentator says, wherever he placed his holy feet, he found a lotus supporting it. And therefore, he became Padmapada. Devotion. Now, when it comes to Totaka, the second Totakacharya, the second disciple who joined him in Shingeri, he was obedient, industrious, and extremely righteous. Extremely righteous. And he was not concerned about knowledge. He was just serving his master. So one day, the master was ready to commence his classes. So all the rest of the disciples are ready to take to the classes. Then Shankara was still waiting. Then the students politely asked, whom are you waiting for? Bhagavatpada replies, Totaka has to come. Then the students ridiculed, what does he know? Whether he's going to join the class or not join the class, he's not going to learn anything. Why should we wait for him? The master decided to teach a lesson to the students. And the commentator says, a mere glance, he looks at Totaka, just glance. And Shankara Digvijayam records, he gained mastery over 14 subjects. A mere glance of a guru transformed him into a knowledgeable person, acquisition of knowledge instantaneously in 14 subjects. And how does he exhibit? He immediately sings the Totaka Ashtakam in the Totaka meter, which is the celebrated hymn of Shankara even today, Vidita Akila Shastra. Somebody was just not competent, by the mere glance, writes it. So, surrender, service can fetch the very same result which knowledge can fetch. Totaka represents that school of thought. Now the third disciple is Hastamalaka. He was a dumb, dull boy who can't speak. And his father considered him a big liability. So father takes the son to Shankara and shows him. Shankara sees the son, the child, and says, who are you? The child speaks immediately and says, I am one who has conquered the six states of grief. What are those six states of grief? Infatuation, hunger, thirst, sorrow, old age, and death. And says further, I am one who has traveled beyond the six conditions of life: birth, continuation, growth, disease, decay, and death. And sings all this in 12 poems instantaneously before his guru. And Acharya immediately conveyed to his father, look here, after all you are considering him as a liability. He is not going to be of any use to you. Let him be my disciple. I want to take it. And he joins as the third disciple to Shankara. What does this story convey to us? It conveys to us that the test of rebirth. We are all talking about prodigies. We see YouTube every day. Some 2-year-old child, 7-year-old child, 10-year-old child displaying dazzling qualities. And we all get baffled. How is this possible? Technically, how is this possible? If one believes in karma, one believes in rebirth, it is possible. So it's a continuation of all the Purva Janma Punya of previous birth. But the point is, you have the ability to attain emancipation. You are filled with that knowledge, but it is in a sealed container. Imagine a scent bottle, completely airtight closed. Unless somebody releases that lid, the aroma can never hit the room. So the effort to remove allows the aroma to reach. In scent bottle, you and I can do it. But in emancipation, only an evolved guru can do it. The child has to come into contact with that evolved guru. So when the child came into contact with Bhagavatpada, just on seeing him, by sheer seeing, he transforms into a pure Atma. It's the third episode. And the fourth one is Sureshwaracharya, who was the first Pitadhipati of the Shingeri Mutt. Now, so in the case of Sureshwara, it was an intellectual fight. Sureshwara was one who was a die-hard karma follower. He believed the beginning and end of life is only doing rituals. It is nothing. Vedas stand only for rituals and nothing else. So Shankara engaged in a debate with Sureshwaracharya, with his wife as the mediator, as the umpire, who was none other than Goddess Saraswati in the name of Ubhaya Bharati. And the adjudication results were pronounced even before the contest. One who loses should take to that ashram. If Shankara loses, he will become a grihastha. If Sureshwaracharya loses, he will become a sannyasi. And the debate finally ended in favor of Shankara, because it was he just proved it like a back of a palm that Vedas do not stop with rituals and there is much more, and cited from the Vedic text, not from the Vedantic text. He showed Vedic text to say these expressions in the Veda communicate and impress upon the fact that one has to go to Vedanta to reach salvation. Vedas don't take you to salvation. So, what does this Shishya convey to all of us? You might have a different point of view in life. But when somebody confronts you with a better idea and persuades you and win over you, do you have the mind to accept defeat? A, accepting the defeat graciously. Two, not just accepting the defeat, following the other school of thought. Digvijayam beautifully explains, portrays how Sureshwara, as a majestic grahastha, a rich grahastha, adorning silk robes, adorning jewels, adorning earrings, kankanas, doing karmas and giving huge charity, gave up everything one day when he lost and transformed, took to Kashaya Vastra and walked behind his. So, accepting defeat, knowing fully well that the other man's point of view is right, and then following that course of life. I think this is something which is impossible in our lives, in our modern lives. Whether it's a small conversation between family members or a board meeting or a political decision, it's impossible. So this is the message the fourth Shishya seeks to communicate. So in short, Padmapada represents knowledge and bhakti. Totaka for total surrender. Hastamalaka, a sheer grace. If a guru wishes to shower his grace on a Shishya, transformation of the Shishya is just inevitable. the guru has to wish. And finally, Sureshwaracharya, humility to concede defeat and migrate exactly onto the school which he has been opposing till that time. So these are the four great disciples which Shankara was able to get and use them as their vehicles to propagate the Sanatana Dharma. We come to the last two sections then. For a modern mind, how do you portray Shankara? One, Acharya writes an article, which was of course an article shared by Usha Venkatajalam to me. I consider it very, very, in fact, possible we'll give you copies. It has been translated in English, of course, but puts it in our language, puts it in few buckets, which a modern mind can very easily comprehend. The first bucket is Shankara as a universal benefactor, and says, bhakti to mukti. Shankara's entire works between 12 and 16, for somebody who is a beginner, he has composed stotras just to develop bhakti. Somebody who wants to do mantra, acquire ability in mantra shastras, a big samrajyam of mantra shastram he has composed. Somebody who is attempting to climb the ladder slowly, he has written prakarana gandras like Viveka Chudamani. And for somebody who is in real pursuit to attain jnana, he has written the commentaries on the prasthanatraya. Everything between 12 and 16. So for Shingeri Peetam, whenever there is an Anugraha Bhashyam Adi Shankara, every Acharya says this. There are two prescriptions to this mutt, which needs to be followed by all the Peetadhipatis. Prescription one, it shall be the source of knowledge on our scriptures and the final authority. Anybody who has a doubt, wants to willingly debate and try to understand, the Peetadhipati should be in a position to guide him what the scriptures actually say. So jnanam, absolute knowledge, is one necessary requisite for a Peetadhipati of a Shingeri Mutt. But it can't stop with that. Then you will be catering only to tapasvis and rishis and sannyasis. And therefore Shankara prescribes a second condition. Each Peetadhipati should be the most compassionate companion to his sishya. Avyaja Karunamurti. See the two extremes. The two banks in which the flow of the stream of Shingeri flows. One extreme is absolute knowledge. And the other extreme is handling the most, an infant, struggling, painful sishya. An Acharya does the skipping, climbing up and climbing down, instantaneously, devotee after devotee, when you go and see in the darshan. This has been the task they have been performing for the welfare of the society, uninterrupted for 1,200 years. And therefore claiming the title Avichinna Guru Parampara, unbroken lineage of Peetadhipatis. 1,200 years, how many will find a parallel to say that there's a striking similarity of an institution surviving so long? And Acharya, in one of his speech, when the Vijayanagara Empire was established and Shingeri was established, compares and contrasts it, which I'll discuss it tomorrow. A very interesting narration by Mahasannidham in one of his speeches. Now, when it comes to commentary, he was a commentator par excellence. See, the whole gamut of scriptures, Shankara puts it in 1.5. That's the simplicity of the soul. The whole of truth is said in 1.5 sentence. He says, Brahman alone is truth. Material world is illusion. Mind therefore gets deluded. And there is no difference between the jiva which resides in us and the paramatma which is at large. This is all his truth. Truth is only Brahman, Brahman alone. And Jagat Mithyai. And he says, jiva and paramatma are one and the same. Now, we'll see Shankara as a poet. See, evolved souls, emancipated souls would not prefer to be poets. Poets need not be evolved souls. Acharya says, he's rolled into two. He has rolled both into him. He is an emancipated soul and composing poems for the welfare. That's, see, the unique two jewels are the Saundar Lahari and the Shivananda Lahari. Reading the Shivananda Lahari, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam used to rely on Shivanandari slogans in all his lectures. One has to just shed tears if one has to understand the meaning and import of those tathas glorifying Shiva. We'll just shed tears. Such a language, so sweet, honey as it is, it says. So Shankara was a great poet. Shankara as a yogi. Two episodes which comes up again and again for debate. Two episodes. After defeating Mandana, Ubhay Bharati, before declaring Shankara as the winner, says, you should also debate with me. So Shankara was hesitant. Should I do it with a lady? Then Ubhay Bharati clarifies, Gargi has done it with Yajnavalkya. Suleba has done it in the Sabha of Janaka. Therefore, women are entitled to pursue Vedanta and debate, even though they don't have sanction to pursue Vedic karmas. So Vedanta is a domain common to both sex. So you should debate with me. Shankara engages into a debate with Ubhay Bharati. Keeps arguing, debating. And finally, she puts a question, embarrassing question on love and sex. Then Shankara says, you give me a month's time. I will understand and then come and debate with you. So he talks to his disciple Padmapada and tells him, let me enter the body of a dead king, revive him, and see how he enjoys life and how women enjoy him, and let me understand the signs so that I can go back and debate. And Padmapada raises a caution. He says, should you do it? I have three doubts then. A, will it not be an antithesis to Brahmacharya, which you have been practicing all these years? Two, sensual world is something which is irretrievable for those who have entered into it. So should you enter into it and become irretrievable? And three, how will history speak about you? He raises these three questions. Here comes Shankara and clarifies it. He says, Ashrama Dharmam is only for one who possesses a body, mind, and intellect. Any dharma is only for the body, only for the mind, and only for the intellect. It is not for the atma. And he explains it with an illustration. He says, you are in a waking state, then you go to a dream state, and finally you reach a deep sleep state. In your dream, you kill somebody. Can somebody punish you because you killed somebody in a dream? Will you suffer punishment for that? Then he asks the next question. You perform homas of the largest scale. You invite the best of pandits in your dream. Do a Atirudram. You do a Sahasra Chandi. Can you reap the benefits of those homas because it is done in your dream? Padmapada says no. Therefore, you don't do it in your waking state. You have done it in a dream state. You cannot be punished, nor can you be rewarded. Punyam, papam, is all done in a waking state where you perform this and attain the benefit or attain the wrath. And says, for somebody who is a Jivan Mukta, one who has attained the salvation, nothing touches him. There is nothing, because everything is burnt. There is nothing for to formulate into a punya or into a papa. And cites, this is exactly what Krishna has done in performing the rasa kridi. in that state. And if we read Rasa Krida, the Palasudhi says, one who wants to conquer lust should read it with faith. That's the beauty of that stotra, if understood properly. So, this is one yogic power. And finally, therefore, Shankara said, I will clarify one thing to the world. I will therefore enter only a dead body and not a live body. Because entering a dead body requires yogic power. Not anybody can do it. And therefore, this will be a trend which will be different from the rest. This is one case. The second yogic power exercise which he did was in reaching his mother. He was in Shingeri. He understood that his mother is going to pass away. And he therefore appoints Sureshwaracharya as the Pithadipati of Shingeri and moves. Now the question raised is, how can a sannyasi be by the side of his mother? And how can a sannyasi perform rites for his mother? Jeshtamahasannidhanam in his speeches clarifies two things. When he took to sannyasa, he gave this promise. It is a sannyasa with this qualified promise. So one of the dharmam is, a promise once given should be executed. You can't give a promise and then fail in your promise. So when he took to sannyasa, he assured his mother, I'll be by your side. So he is executing his promise, which is a dharmam. So you can't find fault with Shankara for that. And Jeshtamahasannidhanam also clarifies, how can he perform rites? Again, the same. Any karma, if performed in a human form with a human conduct and a human action, is to be tested with the ashrama dharma. Not for somebody who's emancipated. Shankara is an emancipated soul. No rules apply. This should be borne clearly in mind. Because why do they say so? They can never commit a sin and therefore no rules. Rules are only to identify between punya and papa. An emancipated soul is beyond that. It can never commit a papa, and therefore why should it be put into the realms of these two divisions? This is the answer given by Jeshtamahasannidhanam in his speech. Shankara was an ocean of mercy. Karunyam. When a poor lady with utmost bhakti prays to him, you have come on a dwadasi. I have to feed you my child. I have nothing else but a gooseberry. Please take it out of my, as my humble gift for this. She had nothing else. Shankara then meditates on Mahalakshmi. Can't you not serve this lady? She says, she has not done enough punyam to acquire merit. So what do I do? Shankara replies, she has given me the gooseberry. Does it not merit? Please help her. And torrential rain of gold. And Shankara sings the glorious Kanakadhara Stotra. One who sincerely prays people in penury, sincerely wants to, they are caught, and not for adharma, for a dharmic reason they have to get out of this mess. Sincere prayer of Kanakadhara Stotram will alleviate them from that penury. It's the assurance given in that stotra. So Shankara is an ocean, a brilliant leader. Look at this. Just a question for all of us to ponder. A brilliant leader. No fight. It's an avataram, unlike the dasavataram. No fight. No battle. No war. No bloodshed. And 72 contradictory schools of thought have been vanquished. How? Shankara never assaulted their practices, never insulted them even once, says Digvijayam. He won their hearts. See, every school which got defeated followed Shankara. He never hurt their egos, never humiliated them, never condemned their practices the way, or admonished them the way in a punishing way. He said, started to correct them, started to mend them, started to bend them, so that he did not lose control over them. I think every management scientist should understand and spend his time to find out how this is possible. One of the most important quality for a manager, for a leader, is not to fight but yet bring the other side to his side. Shankara was a standing example. Resolving a misunderstanding. Misunderstandings do happen. When one Shishya wanted to write a book, a text, a sub-commentary, rest of the Shishyas objected to it. Shankara said, all right, there is an objection, you have your competence. How does he resolve it? World will still recognize your competence with pride. Therefore, do write the other two. And two more texts are written. And a new Artikam is written. Then he says, Shankara says, this will be glorified by whomsoever who deals with the subject of Advaita in this world. You agree with the other side, all right, I'll please you, but he will still do what he has to do. And still he will get his due, what he deserves in this world. Resolving misunderstanding, standing by the promise, which I've already said, and a complete national integration with national spirit. Sureshwara from North India is put as the Pitadipadi of Shingeri. Totaka from South India is put as the Pitadipadi in Badri. Unifies India into one, doesn't divide India. Can you find out a person who has that sense of integration of the nation into one, on a philosophical plank? Shankara is a Jagadguru. See, the expression Acharyal says in the Anugraha Bhashanam, Adikadi Solvar, Jagadguru was a title first given to Lord Krishna. Krishnam Vandi Jagadguru. The Lord of the world is Krishna. After that, after 5,000 years, the title Jagadguru was given only to Shankara Bhagavatpada. Nobody in between. And why is he a Jagadguru? Jagadguru is not our democratic process of everybody coming under him. No. Those people are not his followers. No, that's not. Somebody who is capable of reaching every animate and inanimate object in this world. His ability to transcend and reach and makes him a Jagadguru. Not for anything else. So he's a Jagadguru. Infinite faith, infinite knowledge, and infinite compassion. Keep multiplying. One management test. Take his whole personality. Can you subtract something out of it as excludable? You can't do that. Test it. Can you add something to say, no, he has not fulfilled this criteria. He is lacking in this area. Can you do that? No. Please test it. World has tested it for 1,200 years and they have failed. A complete fullness in every aspect, you can test it. You can neither subtract nor add into his personality. Full, because he is bliss. Nothing but bliss. So, we will take the last 2-3 minutes and then for the day. When he established these four mats, he established in the north at Badri and installed Totaka as the Pitadipati and gave Atharvana Veda as the Veda to be followed. And the Mahavakya, I am Atma Brahma. He installed Sureshwara in the south at Shingeri, gave the Yajurveda and the Mahavakya, Aham Brahmasmi. He installed Hastamalaka at Puri in the east, gave the Rigveda and the Mahavakya, Pragyanam Brahma. And installed Padmapada at Dwaraka and gave the Samaveda and with the Mahavakyam Tattvamasi. With the world to follow suit of his practices. His Namavalis, there are 108 which was chanted today. Two of them are very important to us. Bhakta Abhishta Pradayakaya Namaha. Bhaktar Halakka Abhishtate Alipavan. Shankarar. Sishyopatesha Niratayaya Namaha. If something can be done to a Sishya, he will willingly extend his guidance to alleviate his pain. And it goes on, it goes on. It's endless. So how can we contain Shankara in 2 hours? It's not possible. Therefore, it is this Shankara which to a modern mind, you test it from any management principle, will be baffling, will be eluding, and will be defying. You test it in the highest of spiritual plank, baffling, eluding, and defying. Because he is unique in every sense of the term. It has been a wonderful 1.5 hours in my life before you. Tomorrow, I think we made a mistake in issuing the timing at 6:30. It starts every day at 6. Tomorrow, we will start from Sureshwaracharya and the Trinity, the 10th, 11th, and the 12th Acharya. And its relevance today to Sanatana Dharma. What was India in the 12th century? And how the Vijayanagara Samrajyam got established? How Vijayanagaram took the portfolio of administering society? Raja Pariparanam was given to Vijayanagaram, and Dharma Paripalanam was given to the Shingeri Mutt. How did this marriage happen? Why did it happen? And how did the Acharyas acceded to the request of the emperors? And what did they do in turn to the Mutt? All these things, let's see tomorrow. Shri Guru Pyo Namah. Thank you so much.
I think it was sheer grace of Acharya that we could all attend this lecture today. It was an enlightening lecture by Sri N. Venkatraman, and it would not have been easy for him to condense Sri Bhagavatpada's life and works in a capsule form in 1.5 hours. But he's done it beautifully and has highlighted the lessons that we as devotees have to learn from Bhagavatpada's life: Shraddha, Bhakti, Sharanagati, and humility, qualities like humility that we have to imbibe in our lives. We do hope, and another highlight was he worked hard and culled from our Acharya, Jyeshtha Mahasannidhanam and Sri Sannidhanam's lectures to clarify many doubts and that may rise in our minds, because we are not so conversant and we do not have that kind of logical clarity in our minds. I think with Acharya's grace, we will all be present tomorrow and we will continue to learn more about our Guru Parampara. Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha.